Today on NBC Sports, the sixth season of the American Le Mans Series comes to a close. Four different classes fighting for a victory, two titles still on the line, and one of the world's premier road courses. The best in endurance road racing is next.
The American Le Mans Series. Cool cars, world-class drivers, premier road courses. Born in France in 1923 with the first running of the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the ALMS is the glamour, the glory, and the grueling reality of sports car racing, European style, with American attitude. Drivers from around the world strut their speed, skill, and endurance. Four separate classes racing on the track at the same time. It is the chain that connects the new and the faithful sports car fans of an extraordinary endurance racing tradition. This is the American Le Mans Series.
The American Le Mans Series at Mazda Raceway in Laguna Seca. NBC Sports with coverage of the season finale in 2004. Today, it's the Audi Sports Car Championships at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. A huge story at the front of the grid for today's finale. A surprise qualifying on the pole. With that story, Calvin Fish.
Well, Rick, indeed, yesterday we saw a very surprised qualifying performance put in by a team that's making only its second start in ALMS competition this year. The creation team waited patiently while the Audis laid down very strong qualifying times. And then they unleashed their driver, Frenchman Nicolas Manassian, in the number 27 DBA Zytec. Now, the team calls this car the Blue Rocket, and for very good reason, as Nicolas scorched his way around this racetrack to the pole position. But as the race starts today, the question is the car fast but fragile? Can it last 4 hours? And how will their Dunlop tires fare on a racetrack that has been dominated by Michelin runners for the last 5 years?
All right. All right, thank you, Calvin Fish, and welcome to Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca for our coverage of the season finale of the American Le Mans Series. With Bill Adam, I'm Rick Benjamin. Beautiful weekend for racing here, and two championships are yet to be decided. Bill, the first is in Prototype 2.
Prototype 2, very, very close right down to the finish here. It looks like Ian James will have the victory driving this brand new Courage from France, but the Clentfield team could still take it. If Ian James completes 70% of the race distance, the championship is his, however.
James Gouet, who's second in the points behind James, can't possibly win the title because they share the same car. Now in GT, it's been a very tight battle. Alex Jobe's team has been dominant. Timo Bernhard, though, does need to have a good day.
He does indeed. Timo has had a good season, but they've been challenged very strongly all year long by the Flying Lizard team. If Flying Lizard wins today and Timo Bernhard and his teammate Jörg Burgmeister come seventh, then Flying Lizard wins that championship.
So the championships are up for grabs in GT and Prototype 2. And before the drivers strapped in, we talked to Ian James and Timo Bernhard about their runs here today.
Yeah, obviously so far we've had, you know, great races this year. We won the opening race and now we're here to try and seal the championship in the last and final race. It's a 4 hour race, so we're gonna start it a little conservative, but then we're really gonna push to the end and hopefully we'll bring home another win for Miracle Motorsport in Yokohama today.
The season has been long and been very successful so far. We had 5 wins in 8 races. That's very successful. Yesterday I grabbed my third pole, was very happy about that. But now this little piece is missing. The last race, I hope I can win this championship. It was a goal from the beginning of the year on, and like I said, we had a good season so far, but it's looking not so bad. Jörg is supporting me and the whole team is supporting me. I have the right tools to win this, but I hope I have this little piece of luck now to get it done.
We'll also be watching the battle in GTS today. This season has been dominated by the CompuWare Corvettes, but The inter-squad battle is a tight one. Down to Jan Beekes.
And it is. Consider the fact that Olivier Beretta has already made history by scoring his 15th pole position in a Corvette, tying the record set by Ron Fellows. But the bigger record that the Corvette team is shooting for is something that no other team in any class has ever done in American Le Mans competition, and that is have a perfect season. The Corvette team has won every race this year. They have a chance to pull it off. On paper, you'd say, hey, this is a slam dunk. Until you consider there's only one racetrack on the schedule the Corvette team has never won, you guessed it, right here at Laguna Seca.
As the field aligns for the season finale of the American Le Mans Series, let's meet our pole sitters in the four individual categories.
Hi, I'm Nick Minassian. I'm driving the number 27 Croatian Autosportif DBA Zytec car, sharing with Jimmy Campbell-Water, and we'll be starting on pole today.
Hi, I'm Ian James. I'm driving the number 10 Miracle Motorsport Garage with James Dewey. I'm going to grab the pole here at Laguna Seca for P2 cars.
I'm Olivier Beretta, driving the number 4. We did the pole today in Laguna Seca, and I'm driving with Oliver Gavin for GM Racing.
Hello, I'm Timo Bernhard. I'm driving the number 23 McKenna Electro Porsche together with Jörg Backmeister, and we grab the pole in GT.
And at the top of your screen, we will show you the rest of today's 26-car starting lineup. One note in GTS, the Asemco Saleen, the 63 car, sent to the back of the grid for the start. They failed the leak down test after final qualifying yesterday. Let's take a look at our Michelin tire field summary today. As always, five different brands of tires and a surprise, Bill, on that pole-winning car.
It is a surprise, and I think the one thing we have to watch for is how well these Dunlops will perform off the start. We've seen all season long, Michelin is extremely good immediately. Other tires sometimes take a little bit of time to come to temperature, so that's the mystery right now.
This is a 2.25-mile racetrack here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. A lot of elevation changes. The world-famous corkscrew, cars heading to the final corner, the short front straightaway where pit road is located. I think the 27 cars got to get a good start here.
They do, and look at the guy alongside, J.J. Lehto, one of the best starting race drivers.
Get ready, get ready, get ready.
You hear the crew chief, they're warning them.
Start.
Look at that two champion out. He's almost bumped off the start. There are Dyson cars alongside as well going down into turn two.
Manassian with the early lead in the 27 car. The Audi is second. The Dyson car third. That's one of those Lolas.
Oh, and he got hit.
Audi gets turned around. That's the two car. Johnny Herbert. Herbert gets bumped off the racetrack. Here come the Corvettes.
Johnny wisely sitting, taking his time. He does not want to pull on the track, get in the way of somebody else flying up. This is 4 hours long. He's a mature driver. He knows he doesn't have to rush it to get back into the field, but he'll be hot.
But it is hard to pass you.
Oh, extremely hard. Interesting talking to Nick Minassian. Here we are on board with JJ. Now, this is the Audi R8. Dramatically different cars. The Audi, of course, turbocharged. The car immediately ahead, normally aspirated.
And the leader right now, the Reynard with the Zytec motor, the 27, that's a much lighter race car.
And so far, it looks pretty good. I'm not seeing any signs of the car wiggling as it goes around the track, so I think the Dunlop tires look pretty good right now.
Take another look at what happened in turn two.
Now, that was one of the Dyson cars, and you know, I think it was Chris Dyson. That's very uncharacteristic. Chris Dyson, somebody I would trust any day. Here we are, just look at the back of the picture. And right,
I think Herbert turned down on.
Well, you know what? He had a right to turn in, actually. At that point, Chris really should have backed out. He should have known that Johnny did have the right to come in for the second apex.
Well, Manassian has got experience at this racetrack in a kart champ car as the leader. Right behind him is J.J. Lehto, and there's Mitch Leitzinger. Leitzinger and James Reeder. They pair up in that Thetford Norcole Rob Dyson entry, the 16. They've won a race this year.
Yeah, and I expected this to be one of the better cars at this track, but it was interesting talking to Chris yesterday. He said that it really hasn't been as perfect as what they had hoped. And they've tried different programs, bringing the boost in for their turbos at different levels to stop the wheel spin for this very light car.
National leader of the 27 Creation Motorsports team. Right behind him, J.J. Lehto and the ADT champion Audi R8. They have been dominant this season. Leading the Drivers' Championship. In fact, he's already locked it up in prototype.
And this should be incentive for a lot of teams out there to look at it. The Creation team only has 10 full-time employees. That's about as small a racing team as you could ask for. And yet, here they are running ahead of the greatest sports racing car ever built, the Audi R8.
That is a Reynard chassis built to the letter of the old 675 specs. Now, when the categories were changed several months ago, they decided to move that car into P1 with that Zytec motor, which is a V8.
Yeah, and some of our viewers, if they have real sharp eyes, they may be looking at this car thinking, I think I've seen it, and yes, you have. John Nielsen brought that very car over to run Petit Le Mans a couple of years ago. Didn't have much success with it. The car initially was designed and built by Raynard, and they got this chassis out of the factory before the whole thing went defunct. You can see it's a really fine little race car. JJ working hard here in the Audi R8. Look at our Porsche Digital Pilot onboard telemetry here. Take an idea of the speeds around the track. And for new viewers, watch how quickly this car accelerates and decelerates, braking as well.
Turbo boost on the right, G-forces on the left. Speed at the top, you're riding with Leto up the hill here toward the corkscrew. Leaders Panashian up ahead in that blue number 27.
What a season JJ Leto has had in that ADT Champion car. It has just been wonderful. And we both noticed yesterday that he seems to be driving with a great deal of confidence and joy. He's having a really good time.
How about T2? This is Jeff Buckham's car, the 56. Not a contender for the championship. That Lola AER, he's off the look at this. He's ahead of Herbert for the moment.
There's Johnny. He's slicing his way back up through the field. I expect that Buckham, not taking anything away from their team because they've done a good job here, but I expect he is sitting in that position right now, largely because of the spin. He probably just got through and other people had to scatter to avoid Johnny spinning out.
Now the Paul Sitter at Prototype 2, we talked to them earlier. It was the car of Ian James and James Gouet, the Miracle Motorsports 10 car. But Buckham has gotten by them. The 10 back in 14th overall right now. Buckham up in 8.
And exactly as Ian James predicted when he chatted with Calvin, he said they was going to take it very easy to start. And I think that's a wise thing to do. We're going to see in the GT class, when we get back into that, that there's going to be a lot of different schools of thought. That do you protect your championship lead? Do you try and stay out of trouble? But frequently, when you try to save something and you're driving at a slower pace, that's when you get into trouble because you've relaxed your concentration. Here's Ian James just going by the leader right there.
In GT, the lead car right now is that number 23, Timo Bernhard. All he needs is sixth or better to lock up the Drivers' Championship. He's teamed again with Jörg Bergmeister. Bergmeister missed a race earlier this year, so he can't contend for the title.
Correct. And Timo is all set for this race, doing a really fine job for the Alexio team once again.
Early in the going, three laps are complete here at Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca. 2004 season finale for the American Le Mans Series. We'll be back. There are your leaders on NBC Sports. Today's NBC Sports coverage of the American Le Mans Series from Laguna Seca being brought to you by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. And by Porsche. Porsche, there is no substitute. Welcome back to Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca with Bill Adam. I'm Rick Benjamin. Season finale for the American Le Mans Series in 2004. We've witnessed a terrific battle up front in Prototype 1 and for overall dominance. And Raynard with the Zytec motor that sat on the pole that was finishing in the 27. He swapped the lead back and forth with JJ Leto a handful of times, but he's still out in front. Here they go by Tom Weichert in the GTS Viper, the Toshiba car. Four categories of cars in American Le Mans competition. At the head of the field, Bill, it's the P1 cars, pretty much unlimited race cars.
These are the real exotics. They're very, very wonderful materials, carbon fiber, honeycomb, aluminum, magnesium, titanium, and a lot of stuff that I'm sure we don't even know what it's called, but they are the fastest sports racing cars in the world, period. Lightweight, lots of horsepower, easily top 200 miles an hour, but they're million-dollar cars.
Leto and that Audi running second right now. Now, P2, very similar cars, open-topped, a little lighter and less power.
They look a lot like them. If you have to look very closely, really, to tell any of the differences at all, but one major thing is they are not allowed the large, powerful engines. These are all smaller. There are no turbochargers. They're somewhat offset, and they can run a lot less weight. And they're a lot more affordable, although still, these are expensive race cars.
Riding with Clint Field, he's got the helmet cam for us here today, and he's leading in Prototype 2. He got by Ian James a few moments ago, and there he is in that click-away car from Intersport Racing. Closing in on the GTA Porsche there, the 43, the S-Network car from BAM Motorsports. We watch Clint Field. Now, this is the driver who's really in the catbird seat for the P2 title, Ian James.
Ian James had such a good season. He really is a very talented young Englishman, just a delight to chat with. And once they got this car, he bonded with it instantly. It has been very quick, very reliable. This is a Courage chassis, one that has been built, developed from a man that used to run Le Mans a great many times, and GTS class finally. This is a production-based race car. Now, I say race car because even though it looks like a Corvette you might drive on the street, Don't kid yourselves. This is 7 liters of pure horsepower, lightweight, very exotic.
You talk about a million-dollar race car. Here's one that's nearly that. These CompuWare Corvettes have won all around the world. They've won at Le Mans, and they're on the verge of a season sweep in American Le Mans that's never been done before. This is Ron Fellows in GTS, currently second.
It's an incredible team. I remember when they started developing this car, back when Olivier Beretta, one of the drivers now with them, was driving the Orica Vipers. They didn't have reliability, they didn't have blazing speed, but they stuck with it and they've got a great car. 23, the Alex Job McKenna Porsche. Well, this is about as state-of-the-art as you can get. The whole team, they have just set record after record in the American Le Mans Series. Timo Bernhard leading the class right now in this car. Another one of these pure race cars built by the Porsche factory. You can actually call them up. They will deliver this car to your door with a key in the ignition and you go and race it.
But be sure and go to driving school before you try that. This is the 23 being driven by GT leader Timo Bernhard. Sixth or better, he wins the championship. Now watch this battle in P1. This is for position. The 37 of John Field, the 20 car of Chris Dyson, they're battling for fifth here.
Yeah, and you're on board the BAM Network car, Lucas Luhr driving. One of these absolute hot shots of Germany. Look at this, you see in the background that that blue Lola just can't quite get by Lucas. Lucas is so good, uses these Porsches. Here he's going alongside, Chris gonna try and follow him. No, smoke off the tires, he locks up. Lucas goes so deep with the Porsche that the exotic cars are still unable to outbreak him.
Right behind the Porsche, the battle for the lead, or rather for position, in P1, two of the Lola chassis with different power plants. Now, the 37 car, the Intersport car, that's got a jump motor. Contact up front, battling for the top spot. Wow, Ashton in the blue car, still there.
Man, the Zytek tried to go around one side, JJ Leto tried to go around the other. Now they're coming up into the hairpin. Look at the traffic ahead.
Down
look
at the
JJ.
Corner. Leto for the lead.
He's got it, down the inside, pass him. But we have to keep in mind, down the end of this straight, a great passing area. JJ swerving, trying to keep him behind. The lighter car is the dark blue one following that white Audi. It is about 350 pounds less. Should have better braking, and let's find out.
Into two, going for the lead again.
Got him.
Benacci trying to take it back. Leto in the Audi tries to jump back at him, can't do it.
Fantastic battle. Each driver using his car just right to the edge.
Now that blue Reynard with the Zytek motor, quicker because it's lighter, right, Bill?
Less weight, so it should be easier to stop the car. Just like if you're trying to stop a big truck or you're trying to stop your street car.
Wow, wild action at the front of the field here at Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca. So Nicholas Minassian is still out in front of the Creation Auto Sportif car. Leto runs second, Butch Leitzinger is third. We'll be back. Some of the color and passion of American Le Mans Series racing at Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca. Hello again, everyone. I'm Bill Adam. I'm Rick Benjamin. Final round of the 2004 championship. In a different format here this weekend, a four-hour race from day into night. This will finish under darkness for the season finale in 2004. Up front, it's been a great battle since the drop of the green. A surprise, Nicholas Minassian on the pole in the brand-new 27 car from Creation Autosport over in Europe. They've led just about all the race. JJ Leto, the season champion and the ABT champion Audi, the 38 car that you see here, has given chase moments ago. Let's take a look at some of the things that have happened in this battle for overall victory here today.
Well, one of the difficulties with classes, right up at the corkscrew, and look at this. JJ has to go wide.
Wow.
He's lucky. At this point, the gravel trap is so smooth, he's able to drive the Audi offline and really only loses a couple of seconds.
Now, these cars aren't designed to go dirt tracking, but the Audi is a tough race car.
Well, today we're seeing a great battle up front, and tire management will once again probably be a key to victory here. I just checked in with the champion racing team on the progress of the number 38 with JJ Leto behind the wheel. I said, will you guys be able to double stint these Michelin tires? Mike Peters, the team manager, said the way JJ's having to push and slide the car around, I don't believe so. We may gamble and try and take two tires on the stop and try and leapfrog that car during the pit stops. Jan Beekers?
Well, in the case for Nicholas Minassian, as they battle on the racetrack, Nicholas Minassian has said he wanted to try and hold a gap before the first pit stop because he knew the Audi was so strong launching out of the pits. But it looks like JJ Leto has pounced and got by him. He's going to try to again get that advantage. Again, he feels that the Audi team is so superior technology they can press a button and launch out of the pits. He wanted to have a gap before the first stop.
Well, what they did was launch that car out of the final turn down the front straightaway. Leto has made his move there a couple of times. Now he's got the lead, a clean racetrack.
Yeah, and I'll give that down to Lato's aggressive nature in driving, because the smaller blue car, lighter weight. Now, here's a replay, and you watch. Coming out of this quick downhill right-hander, up ahead, they both see this car. Now, at this point, Manassian decides to be cautious. Lato goes for it. Deep down the inside, outbreaks him, and Manassian, credit right there. He could easily have turned in, but he would have damaged the nose. Here we're on board JJ, and just watch and listen. Snap down through the gearbox. You see, he didn't even let the car slide out wide there, so he too is giving a little bit of courtesy back to Manassian.
Lapping by one of Kevin Buckler's New Century Mortgage Porsches in GT. Our Porsche mailed to an aerial cam with this look at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Final corner here to the front straightaway. And you can see how Lato was being held up, I guess, by Manassian. He's opened up 20 car lengths.
That's really amazing. I wonder maybe if Manassian's tires are starting to go off, because Lato has pulled away a lot faster than I thought. In fact, Lato just ran about 2 seconds quicker that lap right there than he has run early in this race. That by far is the fastest lap of the race.
Now this is the battle for third overall. Butch Leitzinger and Rob Dyson's Lola with the AAR power, the 16. They won at Mosport earlier this year. And there's the car running in fourth overall, the other ADT champion, Audi. That's the two car with Johnny Herbert in the south.
20 flat.
20 flat. You're just listening to Johnny Herbert's crew chief on that ADT champion crew. Actually, that might have been Leitzinger's crew chief. It sounded like, yeah, it must have been Bob. It's Butch's dad. Saying, okay, son, you're doing a fine job out there. And he does.
Which third overall, James Weaver will share the car with him today as they work through traffic here. Leitzinger to the inside of the White Lightning, the 31 car.
And just coming up behind Ian James there, driving the P2, the red car, just went out of the race.
James in line to become the season champion in prototype 2. If he can complete 70% of the laps run here today, by the time the checkered flag falls in the evening hours. Leitzinger being held up just a little bit right now. This could be a Herbert an opportunity.
Well, Johnny really has been very patient after that opening lap bump that put him around backwards. And he has taken his time. And again, it's the important thing to do, because you really have to settle down as a driver and not let it rattle you. Just get back into that rhythm that you want to have.
Another look at that red car here at the Motorsports in the driver's seat in P2 for the season championship. Ian James on board here. And he's really driving a cautious race, but he knows he has to get to the finish.
Well, it's exactly what he told us he was going to do, that he is doing nothing wrong. He is staying out of trouble, being very consistent, very smooth, not gambling at all.
One advantage that team has this weekend, Bill, is the fact they've got some brand new Yokohama compounds. I mean, they switched to that garage very late in the season at Road America. So it's really a testament to the team and Yokohama in general that they came up with a tire that was even compatible to the car at all. Since that time, Yokohama have gone away, done their homework, and come up here with a very fast race tire. I think right now, Ian James is just pacing himself. He wants to get to that 70% mark to score his first professional driver's championship.
Ian James certainly in great shape to pull that off here today. The American Le Mans Series racing is all about high technology. Earlier this weekend, we sent Bill out to check out the latest in fire protection technology.
One of the biggest fears that a race driver has is, of course, fire. And fire is also a huge fear for crew chiefs and mechanics alike, not only for the damage that can be done by the flames and the heat, but also the residual damage that can be done by the material from the fire extinguisher. A lot of that is very highly corrosive to these exotic metals used in these cars, and particularly to the computers. Normally you get a computer near any liquid at all and psst, it's gone. Well, Champion went looking for something better and got the state-of-the-art system from Ansel, a brand new fire system that is totally non-conductive for electricity. Now, you and I don't have the luxury of having an R8 in our driveway, and don't you wish we did? Yeah, me too. But we do have beautiful brand new digital cameras, we have cell phones and PCs. And if you were to shoot a normal fire extinguisher at those things, well, they'd be ruined. But watch this demonstration. Here is some of the fluid from inside an extinguisher, and watch. There is the cell phone totally under the fluid. It's ringing, you can see a call is coming in. And watch this, I pull it out. Fluid running out of it, and yet it doesn't bother the phone at all. The final test of all, you've always heard us have problems in the sound end of doing our broadcasts. What happens to our microphone if it gets dunked in?
Still working. Now what this all means is that the crews no longer have to worry about all of this work and replacement that would normally take place after a fire. Once the fire is out, the damage is overdone and they have no cleanup with this brand new system from Ansel.
Amazing technology and amazing race cars in action here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. JJ Leto is on top, just more than 3 hours to go of the season finale of the Audi Sports Car Championships. Up next on NBC this Wednesday, the season premiere returns the West Wing. Big changes are coming. Alan Alda and Jimmy Smits among the big stars joining the cast. The West Wing season premiere is Wednesday at 9, 8 central on NBC. Still in the first hour of action, the Audi Sports Car Championships at Laguna Seca. We'll be back on NBC Sports. Welcome back to Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca on NBC Sports, the American Le Mans Sports Car Championship. The finale for 2004. With Bill Adam, I'm Rick Benjamin into hour number two. This four-hour run will take us from daylight hours, bright sunshine, into darkness. An overhead look from your Porsche Mail 2M aerial camera down the main straightaway toward turns one and two. It's been a great battle. Right now, the battle raging for second spot. This is JJ Leto, the race leader. He's been out in front for much of the day. Championships into hour number two with Bill Adam. I'm Rick Benjamin. JJ Leto is your leader. We watch him all alone at the Porsche Mail 2M aerial platform. All the lead cars have been on pit road for their first stops of the day. Let's get an update first to Calvin Fish.
Well, JJ Leto brought the number 38 car in and they went to fuel and kept JJ behind the wheel, but a real trick that the team had up their sleeves was just changing the front tires only. Typically you'd go to all four tires, but this racetrack typically makes the cars understeer a little bit. They're wearing out the front tires, so they're just changing fronts only. That will save them a little bit of time in the pit stop. Meanwhile, the number 27 car is in, Jan.
Yes, and the 27 car made a pit stop a few moments after the 38, and they changed tires but did not change the driver. You can see a little bit of damage up on the right front. He had some contact on the racetrack. The most important thing in this pit stop, the team told him he could have actually gone four more laps, but we wanted to get you on a new set of tires. So that's an indicator that in the warmer weather, the Dunlops are not lasting quite as long. A minute and 9 second stop. Now, for the 16, they went 1 hour and 13 minutes. That is 4 minutes longer than the 27 and the 38. And they changed drivers. James Weaver got in. And that was a routine pit stop until they got to the end. The car did not fire quite as quickly as they would have liked it. So that was over a minute 5 seconds for James Weaver. Now, not the only car that had trouble. The 37 had trouble earlier. In fact, coming down the hill, appeared to be out of fuel.
Copy that. Will it not get on reserve? It'll reserve and it's shut off. I'll try to start it right now. Coming into the pit. Okay, I don't think we can push you unless you get into the pit, actually.
He did eventually get onto pit road, and now they have determined the reserve fuel does not work, so they will pit this car, the 37, about four laps earlier for the duration of the race. Duncan Dayton gets in the car and takes over the duties. Now they'll change the strategy from here on out.
So Dayton back on the racetrack. We watch the Reynard Zytek, pole sitter Nicholas Benassian, there with the number 27, being chased now by Johnny Herbert. Herbert's tried him in a couple of different places.
Johnny continues to drive very smoothly, but aggressively with a real touch on it. He is not willing to risk the car. We've seen a couple of times get almost alongside Benassian and then backs out. If he were to lose the little winglets, you'll see on the nose of this car, just like little dive planes just on the edge. Well, if they were to get knocked off, it could really damage the handling of the car. One of the things that would create even more of a push situation that Calvin referred to that does exist on this track and would wear out his front tires very quickly then.
Favorite spot for the Audis to challenge that, Reynard. The final turn before the pit straightaway. Minassian's got to be a little more cautious there, I think, and protect the inside better.
Yeah, and it's kind of interesting, too, because Minassian's car, the blue car, does have superior braking over the Audi. With it being lighter, it does stop better. We've seen that when he regained the lead with JJ, that great battle going down in turn two. But for some reason, Johnny just simply drives in deeper at that point in the track.
Top of your screen, the overall running order with about 2 hours, 40 minutes to go here today. Moving by some of the P2 cars, there's the GT Ferrari, that's the Ferrari 360 motor, the Ricci car, 35. GTS, of course, it's been a Corvette kind of year. The four car with Ollie Gavin and Olivier Barreto, the three of Johnny O'Connell and Ron Fellows, they've gone back and forth all season long. The four has been in the lead just about all the way. First, we had Barreto starting the car. Gavin is in the car now. He's got Johnny O'Connell back in 12 seconds.
Yeah, and Oliver Gavin, I think, is an immensely talented driver. He is just blindingly fast at every track we have ever seen these cars run at. An incredible talent. And yet, because he drives with a different...
11.7 to the three car.
Okay, there you go. Now, there he is being told by his own crew he has an 11.7 second lead over his teammate. So now he may try and vary his own driving just enough to keep his teammate behind. Because make no mistake about it, there's still the ego in the team. They want to beat the other guy.
Well, Corvette's been at this for several years. Only Audi's had more success in American Le Mans racing than has the Corvette squad. Today, this Pratt & Miller team celebrates its third straight season of dominating the big board GTS class. They've won Le Mans. They've got three straight driver, team, and manufacturer's titles now. Today, they're trying to do something no other team or manufacturer has ever done. American Le Mans season, where Corvette program manager Doug Feehan, the winning never gets old.
You know, when I look back on it, I really wonder how we did it. You just see how it's grown and the success level that it's achieved. It's difficult to put your finger on any one or two things that would have created that.
When Feehan and the GM Brass decided to bring Corvette to the American Le Mans Series, they selected a smaller team with a big heart and a family atmosphere, Pratt & Miller.
The hardest part of putting an organization like this together is obviously finding the right people. You can take people who are highly skilled, great deals of experience as individuals, but taking and melding that into a team and putting it in a framework where everyone has to work together, live together, operate together, engineer together, race together, that's the challenge. That's the most difficult part.
You know, we spend more time with these guys than we do with our wives or our children, so everybody has to get along and have one common goal of winning races, and I think we do a pretty good job of that.
For Gary Pratt, the glory of Le Mans wins and series titles pales in comparison to watching the company he's built grow into a consistent winner.
Without Corvette Racing, 5 years ago, we were a small 5 or 6 man company doing, you know, motorsports prototype work, and this program really brought us alive, gave us opportunity to show our skills. I got to pinch myself every time we, you know, come to work and have the number of people we hear and the number of different kinds of tools we can use that we weren't able to use before. It's just been a, you know, a blessing come true as far as being able to race with what we have available to us now.
This is just like a big family, and it has been largely responsible, I think, for as much success as we've had. These guys know one another, they like one another, and it produces a tremendous product. And I'm just happy to be part of it.
Brand new Corvette C6 racing version due out next year. In GTS, Ollie Gavin continues to lead. Calvin, both these cars have been to pit road.
They have, Rick, and very routine starts with the number 4 that leads and the number 3. Olivier Barreto turned the car over to Ollie Gavin, and it was Ron Fellows who's clinched the championship along with his teammate, Johnny O'Connell. And Johnny O'Connell is now behind the wheel. But when you look at the stats for this year, the driver's championship may be over in the favor of Ron and Johnny, but they're 4 apiece in terms of all victories in GTS. There's nothing that Olivier and Ollie Gavin would like better than to end the season with a win today, ending up 5-4 in the win column. Let's go down to Jan Vikas.
And some bad news for Chris Dyson. Chris, your car's on pit road. Are you guys done?
Yeah, I'm afraid so, yeah. The looks like we lost a piston, unfortunately. The car was going reasonably well. We weren't as quick as we'd like to be, but we were hanging in there. The guys worked so hard all weekend to try to get a good balance for the race. It's a shame to see it end like this.
Tell me about the first turn, the contact with the champion car.
Yeah, it was unfortunate, really. You know, Johnny slid a little wide, and I stuck my nose in underneath him, and it was really, I had nowhere to go. He just turned in on me. I couldn't back out of it. I was committed. You know, I'm sure I'll talk to him afterwards, but, you know, it was one of these typical racing incidents, really.
Thank you.
So the 20 car, Andy Wallace, had just gotten in. They're done for the day with a broken motor. As always, as we take a look from on high, our Porsche mail-to-web aerial cam, get all the information you need about the American Le Mans Series at our website, which is AmericanLeMans.com. And we'll be back with more of the American Le Mans Series at Laguna Seca in California after these words from your local NBC stations. Welcome back to Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca on NBC Sports, the American Le Mans Sports Car Championships, the season finale for 2004. With Calvin Fish, Jan Beekhuis, and Bill Adam, I'm Rick Benjamin. Great to have you with us today. Picture-perfect weekend to close out the 2004 season. Very close to Pebble Beach here, of course, on the Monterey Peninsula. You couldn't ask for better October weather than we've enjoyed here so far. And so far, it has been an Audi-dominated run after the first 20 minutes or so. J.J. Leto, the overall leader. But, Bill, the action in GT, always terrific. And you see how much joke cars out there.
Jörg Bergmeister right now on board this number 23 Mechanic Porsche has really done everything that he needed to do to try and ensure that his teammate Timo Bernhard wins the championship this year. They have led from the drop of the green. They have not been challenged. As you see, the car doesn't have a mark on it. He has driven it.
Now, Timo started one more race. Jörg was ill and missed a race this season, so they don't have the same point total. So Timo would claim the GT Drivers' Championship all alone if he finishes sixth or better today. They've led all the way in GT.
And Jörg is going to be as happy as possible for his own teammate to win. These guys get along remarkably well. They're joking together. They fool around together all the time. It's like racing with your best friend.
They've been teammates the last several seasons for Alex Jope. Now, second in GT belongs to the other Jope car as the 23 moves by. It's the number 24. New driver pairing in that car this season. Mark Lieb there the last several races with Romain Dumas. Right now, it's Dumas driving the car 13th overall.
Dumas has been something of a pleasant surprise, too, for the Alex Jope team. That all of the tracks this year have virtually been new to him, and yet he has been very quick. So he's obviously a very fast learner. He is picked up by Porsche for good reason. They seem to have a number of people within the Porsche organization that have a talent for being able to recognize abilities.
Right behind the Porsche, you've got a glimpse there of the Panos Esperante, the 50. Also in GT, Gunnar Jeanette driving that machine right now. They are 19th overall. Third in GT at the moment, Johannes van Overbeek. This is one of the Flying Lizard cars, the 45. And they're in contention for the championship.
They can still do it. I mean, running in third place, but they have to hope that Bergmeister, running in that number 23 car, has a problem. If Bergmeister is to finish seventh or worse, and they can come through with a win, then they would take the championship.
And Bill, the interesting thing about all the GT runners, they've all made their first pit stop, and they've made it past the very important window of 1 hour and 20 minutes. If you can get past 1 hour and 20 minutes, it becomes only a two-stop race. So all the top runners only have one more time on pit road for a four-hour race.
Wow. Well, these cars don't use as much fuel. They're not as hard on tires because they're lighter weight.
Remarkable cars. I mean, nowadays, a lot of the technology we're getting on our street cars are being taken from the racing end of the game and applied to us. I mean, even current Porsches that you see on the street, you have a 340 horsepower car in the street, and yet driving on the highway at 70 miles an hour, you're getting 29 to 30 miles to the gallon. That's because of the technology, the refinement that's constantly going on in these motors.
Jörg Bergmeister continuing the lead. Let's get an update on that team's efforts. Calvin.
His teammate Timo Bernhard, you lead the championship. It's been a perfect weekend. You've been fastest in every session. You lead the race. How nervous are you now? You hand the car over to Jörg and you have to wait.
I'm not very nervous because I'm driving with Jörg now for 3 years and we know each other. And I rely on him and I know he's going to do the job and he's very good. But let's see. We were always fast in all the sessions and now in the race we have a comfortable lead. But let's see. It's still a long race.
Certainly a long race. A lot of pressure on him today. Think about this fact, Rick. All eight Porsche factory drivers, their contracts are up, so there's a lot to play for tonight.
That is not a lot.
Nothing like a contract drive to get your attention at the end of a season.
No pressure at all, just knowing that if you make the mistake, you can kiss next year goodbye.
In front of the leader, you see David Murray there in the 31, the Peterson White Lightning car. Jan Beekhuis.
A little bit of trouble on the front wheels on the 30 machine. Their pit stop was going fairly routinely, and they're having a bit of a delay. Now that the right front is done, it is the left front that seems to be holding up this pit stop. So a fairly routine with Robin Liddell in the seat at the moment is somewhat delayed while they have trouble on the left front.
Now this is the other car from the Intersport stable. This is their P2 car, and they were out front earlier. Right now, Ian James solidly in the lead of P2. James, of course, in line with the Drivers' Championship. This team with an opportunity, and they've won five times this year.
They have, and I'm a bit concerned right now that it seems that the crew is working on this car at a pretty leisurely pace. Now that looked like that wasn't really a fire extinguisher. That is probably charged with thick fluid, like a cooling fluid, a mixture of antifreeze and water, and they pressurize that so that they can basically flush the whole system to cool the motor down. So maybe they're having that sort of problem.
Liddell has been a great GT racer over the years, moving to Prototype 2 this year, loves racing this car, he told me yesterday. JJ Leto continues to lead, but let's show you the top cars in the GT category here at Laguna Seca. Final race of the season for America. The Bob Bergmaster is out in front. Dumont, his teammate, Bob, for being third. Then Jackson and David Murray. The Flying Lizard team scored one win this season. It was back in Mid-Ohio this summer. That catapulted them into a championship challenge position here this weekend. We'll be back. Back at Laguna Seca in California on NBC Sports, the American Le Mans Series season finale in 2004. Coming to NBC in 2 weeks from deep in the heart of Texas, the Breeders' Cup World Thoroughbred Championships. Kentucky Derby and Preakness winner Funnyside is back, some say better than ever. The horse from humble beginnings will take to the track on racing's richest day, the Breeders' Cup, Saturday, October 30th, only on NBC Sports. Well, J.J. Leto showing that great breeding, you might say, here today. Bill Adam, he's leading as we approach the two-hour mark here today. Leto has battled with Nick Minassian. Minassian the pole sitter, and Leto took over a while back, and no one's been able to get close to him.
Well, Minassian and their team, they continue to impress me. I mean, this little creation team does have only 10 full-time employees, and yet they're still running a very solid second place. In fact, they're lapping just as quickly as either Herbert or Leto.
Leto continues to lead. Let's check in again on GT. Porsche is dominating here, fourth in the category. This is the great veteran David Murray in the Peterson White Lightning 31 car. Final quarter here, heading up onto the main straightaway. Murray chasing him, Jovan Overbeek in that Flying Lizard car. Murray's got several American Le Mans wins in his career, but fourth here today.
Well, they're running fourth right now, but
problems for Ian James.
No,
sixth overall, leading P2. Remember, James needed a great day here today.
That's right. They have to get 70%.
Ian, what is happening? What is the problem?
Okay, let's listen.
Still running.
It's still running, but there's no sort of RPM. I can't hear the engine. Right there, he just downshifted there.
Powered by an AER motor, but the AER motor says sick.
Well, it's hard to tell because sometimes at very low RPM, these things really don't sound proper. It's not until they get smooth at the high revs. Well, Ian just has to go through the corkscrew here and then kind of get down into the pit lane, so.
Jeff Buckland, second in P2. He's coming to pit road in the 56 car. With two other drivers.
Now, Ian James should be just the course right now heading down towards pit, so he'll be in there in a couple of seconds.
Jeff Buckham, not a championship contender. Buckham up in speed. We're hearing that there might be some throttle response problems in that race car.
The word that he radioed in said that if he presses more than 50% on the throttle, it shuts off. Now, there's Ian. You just see the top of the car. Whoa, man. Oh, gosh, he couldn't even turn it tight enough.
Can't get it to his pit stop.
Oh, no. Come on, Ian, keep it going.
I'll bet you he went off, and he's got some sort of front steering problem there. If he can't turn the car.
No, I'm not sure. I can't see any. I mean, this damage right here, I think he just did that.
Ian, what's the problem?
I don't see any damage to the car. Just looked at Mike Guay, who leads this crew here. They're going to the tail, so there's some kind of engine or electrical problem. Now, Petit Le Mans, this car doesn't score any points there because they had an alternator problem they couldn't rectify during the race. That is what really got them into this position where they couldn't clinch the championship one round ago. So it's really a heartbreak situation for this team if they're unable to get this car back on track and get it to 70% distance. So here you see the covers coming off the back end. And now taking a look as one of the engine guys there. And actually, they're looking towards the drivetrain here. We'll try and get a quick word with Ian. Ian, what's the problem?
The car just wouldn't turn all of a sudden, so we're not quite sure what the problem is right now. Maybe a rear push rod or something.
Well, there you hear it from the driver himself, some kind of steering issue, and they believe it's in the rear end of the car, Rick.
A rear push rod broken, that's under a suspension, Bill, and that would bind the car and not allow it to turn?
Well, if it's giving the rear wheels either a tow-out or tow-in situation, it's going to change the car so dramatically. It's almost like putting steering on both ends of the car.
Well, often the case in P2, it's a case of last team standing at the checkered flag. Take a listen now to what we heard a moment ago.
What the?
Downshifting into turn two. And then wouldn't turn.
That sounded almost like the brakes went on. He just decelerated so quickly.
Well, I wondered if there might have been a gear broken in the transaction.
No, you would have heard a tremendous gnashing and wailing going on there if a gear had broken. There would have been all sorts of noise there, but that was just rapid deceleration.
Now, let's recap the situation. They have to go 70% of the distance here today. We're not even to the two-hour mark. Let's get more of Prototype 2, Jan Beekes.
Well, we saw the 56 car of the team racing coming on pit road. This is why it was a very quick pit stop. This is a tear-off that came off someone's helmet that was stuck in the intake. And, of course, if that's stuck in your intake, that's going to overheat the car. They caught it in time. They're A-OK now, but spent some extra time on pit road.
We were hearing that they couldn't get more than 50% throttle without the engine cutting out.
Yeah.
That would be why.
That's right. Now, I'll try and show you the intake you're talking about. These cars have the amount of airflow regulated right up at the top of the car. Just see that little tiny trumpet opening. That is carefully regulated by the ALMS governing body so that you, there is signaling there, everything's good. Water relief, that's gotta be. Well, if you're already shut down to that tiny little opening and suddenly the big chunk of plastic was in there, no wonder the engine wouldn't run properly.
And Jeff Buckland just took the lead in Prototype 2. He's ninth overall. Well, part of the American Le Mans weekend here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, the finale of the Star Mazda Open Wheel Series in 2004. Let's show you the highlights. As always here, a full field of Star Mazda cars. Big traffic jam going into turn two. This was earlier in the day. One car around, several drivers into the gravel, and there was more action later on. Several cars off course in a later incident. After the restart, Michael McDowell in car number two started to pull away, leading by 4 points. Jamie Bach in the 34 had problems, and he would stop, and his car failed short of the finish today. Luis Schiavo is always a contender in Star Mazda. He's in that red number one. He'll move inside Michael McDowell in turn two and take over the race lead. This was earlier today. David Stover, running seventh, spun off the racetrack at a high-speed part of Laguna Seca. That's the 69 car. He was into the gravel. Colin Brown here in the 48 gets together with Rafael Matez. It was tough racing all around. Matez back on the racetrack. Late in the race, Schiavo in car number one, all alone out in front. He was on his way to his first victory in 2004. Michael McDowell runs second in car number two, and he is the season champion in Star Mazda Racing in 2004. And we'll be back with more of the American Le Mans Series Sports Car Championship from Laguna Seca. We continue on NBC Sports. Our NBC Sports coverage of the American Le Mans Series at Laguna Seca being brought to you today by Mazda, always the soul of a sports car. Trouble on pit row, the pole sitter, Jan Beekes is there.
Yes, and it appears as though the throttle is sticking open for Nicholas Manassian. They're going to take the back of the car off to check near the engine. They're going to take the nose box off to check the pedal box. And they made a last-minute decision to go ahead while they're working on it to make a driver change. Initially, they wanted to keep Nicholas Manassian in the car. Now have changed their mind because they have to go to the pedal box anyway. Looks like it'll be a lot of time lost. Calvin?
We're down here at the 10-pit yard, and the Miracle Motorsports team has gone to work. They've identified the problem, the right front toe link on this number 10 garage. They've changed it. When I looked at the piece, it's remarkable that Ian James would get this car back to pit lane. They've done a driver change. They're now refueling the car. They've got James Gue behind the wheel to try and get this car back on track to score those vital points today.
Now they missed about 11 minutes of racing, though, so they're not out of it.
No, not at all. Keep in mind, all they have to get is that magical 70% figure. So that's the importance of getting this car back on the track.
If they could finish now, they needed to get a little less than 3 hours of the race complete. They've only missed about 11 minutes, so they've got more than an hour to go. They've got an opportunity to make it work here. The 10 team, the Miracle Motorsports bunch, still working on the front of the car. Remember, at American Le Mans competition, to make a stop, you have to shut the car off, fuel it, then change the tires, then refire and leave.
Yes. Yeah, everything is done with safety in mind here. Oops, having to refire there, reaching the right hand over. There, he got it going.
Going back to the 27.
Motors, reset the fuel. Reset the fuel, please.
Yeah, maybe just to explain to viewers who might be new to our form of racing, these cars do carry pretty sophisticated onboard computers. It's similar to what you get on a lot of new cars nowadays to show fuel mileage. Well, they don't care about mileage per se. but they want to know exactly how much fuel they have left in the tank. And in B2, another car has taken over. This is the Intersport 30. They've won five times this year. This is Robin Liddell from England driving the car now.
Scotland, I beg your pardon.
Oh, excuse me.
Look at this right here.
Mayville. Robin Liddell races out of the UK now, I should say. He's at the throttle. They've taken over the lead in P2, and they're running ninth overall. It's a very good outing for this Intersport team. And they're going for their sixth win of the season, but they've had some DNFs. They could still win the title if the Miracle Motorsports team runs into more problems.
It is an uphill battle. Robin has had a really good season with this. He joined the American Le Mans Series a couple of years ago, driving one of the Porsches, and did a very, very nice job. Was closely allied with now there's on board the BAM car with Leo Hendry.
He's got the 30 in his sights. The 30 moving by on the inside. Leo Hendry steering the S-Network Porsche, as is customary. This is apparently going to be Leo's final outing in the American Le Mans Series with his BAM Motorsports team. He's got Lucas Lohr and Sacha Bossin with him this weekend, hoping to go out in style, but it doesn't appear that it'll happen. Leo had some problems a few moments ago, went off course briefly. God, one of the great guys in the sport.
He really is. I mean, I went over to him earlier this morning before the race, and I had read something that he wrote about this being perhaps the final race, and what a joy it was to be with two stars like Sacha Mass and Lucas Lohr. He just simply enjoys the entire atmosphere of the American Le Mans Series. He loves the people here. He loves the racetracks, and I get a great kick out of anybody who enjoys their sport this much. Look at this, he's here, he's this big high-tech CEO, and he's out there having a ball with this car.
Now the chairman emeritus of the YES Network, working hard on the John Kerry for President campaign. Let's get an update from pit road, more on the 27 car's problems. John Bikas.
They're in the process right now of trying to get this car refired. We saw that they went ahead and changed drivers, and they used about a half a can of WD-40. There were no wrenches used, it was all done with brake clean and WD-40, so they're hoping a little bit of lubricant somehow is going to keep this throttle from sticking.
Now, that car is very reliable, or the motor package very reliable.
Yes.
We talked to them earlier in the week, and they've only had one failure in years.
Yeah, pretty incredible. We saw this car appear road alive. There we are, we're on board that number 10 car, back underway. That's the garage.
They have had to serve a penalty on pit road. One extra man over the wall working on the car. They're going to come in, we're told now, and serve the penalty. It'll probably be a stop and go. And so the Miracle Motorsports team with more problems to fight through. But again, remember, they just need to complete 70% of the race distance, score sufficient points to lock down the championship here today. They've got ample opportunity to do that with an hour and 2 minutes left of racing here today.
And I think
2 hours, 2 minutes.
Ian James' blood pressure must just have doubled when that little problem arose with this car. Oh, he's coming back in the pits right now to get the check.
This is the penalty. Should be a stop and go.
Okay, he's wondering where to stop. Well, that was curious. He is waving the official saying, where do you want me to go?
Back to GT. This is one of Kevin Buckler's Racers Group cars. Quick look at the 66. And here comes the Miracle Motorsports car. They will stop at the box, at the sign, at the cross flag, and it'll be a 1 minute penalty, we're told. Not a stop and go.
Oh.
Stop and long, long stop
well,
before a go.
1 minute at this point really isn't going to matter at all, whether it's 1 minute or 5 minutes. The only thing to worry about now is that if this car is sitting running, he has to be careful to monitor the temperatures because he doesn't want anything to overheat as he's sitting idling. Race cars are not equipped with the fans like what you get on the street.
Back to the New Century Mortgage Porsche. This is Court Wagner driving for Kevin Buckley this weekend, fifth in class. Patrick Long, his co-driver on this team. Long, a hired gun, a young superstar for Porsche. And he had a unique opportunity earlier this week. You know, life on the road for the American Le Mans Series team. Not all testing and preparation for racing. Sometimes you get to feed the passion. Check out a new hobby. Patrick Long and a couple of his young Porsche teammates did just that when they visited Half Moon Bay, California, on their way down to Laguna Seca. Half Moon Bay, California, is the home of Jeff Clark. He's the world's foremost big wave surfer. Clark owns Maverick Surf Shop, which is aptly located near some of the best big surf anywhere. Now, the waves near Half Moon Bay reach heights of 80 feet. Jeff was the first to master these waters. After a tour of the shop and a look at the calmer side of Mavericks, turnabout was fair play. So Patrick Long gave Jeff a look at his world from the right-hand seat of his New Century Porsche.
I'm looking forward to this man showing what this world is all about.
As you can imagine, Clark was pretty impressed, especially with the run down the corkscrew, which he says is like falling down the front of a big wave.
So cool. Very fun. Unreal, man.
Kahoo Bay, a place to check out as well when you head to the Monterey Peninsula of California. So Kurt Wagner in that 66 car with Patrick Ross. Driver change perhaps upcoming for the Audi team. Let's show you the category leaders as we approach halfway at Laguna Seca on NBC. Tonight at Laguna Seca in California here on NBC Sports, the American Le Mans Sports Car Championships. Bill Adam, the Benjamin season finale for 2004. Calvin Fish and Jan Vikas are on pit road, and the Audis continue to dominate. An early run to the front by the Reynard Zytek, the 27 car, but since then it's been all Audi. Now, though, it's Johnny Herbert in car number two who's taken over because their team car, the other ADT champion machine, has been to pit road. Herbert has fought hard to get that car back into contention on lap number 93. He is out in front. Let's take a look at some of the action on pit road earlier. This is the 38 car that was in the lead. J.J. Leto gave up the point, came in, helped his teammate Marco Werner get the belt set. It was pretty much a smooth stop, Bill.
Yeah, very much, and yet we heard Brad Kettler, the crew chief, warning Marco, saying, take it easy, it's getting cold. He did it twice, and still watching Marco leave the pits. The car is snaking all over the place, and it isn't even really cool yet.
Well, let's get an update from the gentleman who started that car today, Calvin Fish.
Down here with J.J. Leto. J.J., great opening stint there. Talk about the battle you had with Manassian in the 27 car.
Well, you know, it was good fight with Manassian. You know, he was doing a good job, and their car was working really, really well. I knew that I can't get by, you know, easily. And I didn't want to cause any problems, you know, or hit anybody. So I just thought, let's race and let's see, you know, how these tires are doing. And I was just saving my car a lot, you know, braking early. Just sort of following him, you know, but it was very, very difficult to get by. There was a couple of times we had really good battle clean, you know, I got by, he got by again, you know, and it was just nice to fight. I think that they had a problem just a little while ago, so unfortunately, but they were running really well. Otherwise, our Audi has been running well, and you know, it was a really good opening stint. I got a good gap, you know, and good lead already after the second stint. Little problem with the tires, you know, just temperature is dropping a lot, and it really causes a lot of problems with the tires. You start to get a lot of oversteering and understeering. And we decided in the first stop only to change the front tires because I had understeering. And we thought maybe we can get the balance back, but it was oversteering then.
Okay, well, six wins on the year, they go for seven. That would be a record, Jan Vikas.
Yes, and Nicholas Manassian, the bad news is they just take your 27 car and put it behind the wall. What was the problem?
We have been at the beginning of the second stint, we start to overheat a little bit on the engine. And that's been causing the throttle to stick. So the more I was driving, the more the throttle was sticky, and until suddenly it just got stuck completely, you know. So it's pretty dangerous to drive like this. It's a shame. They're probably going to try to repair it in the garage and go out again, because it's always good to finish a race. But I'd say the show is a little finished somewhere, you know.
Tell us about your battle that you had at the beginning of the race. It was a fantastic battle with the champion team.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, I love fighting like this, you know. It was really clean. Well, a very good fight. I mean, there is some portion where they're better, or is better than me, some portion I'm better than them. So, hey, well, it was very good. I loved it. Good.
Thank you. We enjoyed watching it.
Thank you.
Hope they bring that car back. They came to Petit Le Mans. They plan to run some American Le Mans races. They contest the European Endurance, the Le Mans Endurance Championship over in Europe. And a very impressive team. As we watch the two cars, Johnny Herbert and the ADT champion Audi, the second of their two-car team, leading now by just a lap. Earlier, back on Wednesday, they call this Mini Le Mans in the city of San Jose. This is in Cesar Chavez Park. Several cars and drivers from the American Le Mans series traveling about 100 miles north to make some new fans and friends for the series before this weekend's run at Laguna Seca. They even ran some of the cars around the park in front of a horde of onlookers who were extremely enthused. Many of the drivers getting an opportunity to sign some autographs as well. Into hour number three, we'll be back with more of the America Le Mans series at Laguna Seca after these words from our NBC stations. Timing and scoring of today's American Lost in the Le Mans Series event here at Laguna Seca, being brought to you by Jean Richard Swiss Watches. They're the official timekeeper and watch of the American Le Mans Series. One of the prototype two contenders back on pit road with problem, John Bikas.
Yes, and it's the 56, and they're having trouble with a battery, electrical issues with this car. They've already been on pit road 2 minutes and 12 seconds, and they're going to change the battery, which is located next to the driver. Ryan Woman is in the car at the moment. He just got into the car. In the meantime, let's get down to Calvin.
Leader is on pit road. It's number two driven by Johnny Herbert, the second of the champion Audis. Turn it over now to the young German Pierre Kammer. He was fast, but he is definitely a man you need to watch. He needs to keep it on the island. He gives it 100% all of the time. We expect this to be a four-tire change. Remember, on the first starts, both of the champion cars were just front tires only. But when they turn it over to a new guy, they look to put a new set of stickers on the car. 49 laps on this thinner tire, so the Michelin tires are working well, but no way they can double stick them today, I don't believe.
Haven't had a chance to see Pierre Kammer yet this year. You're like, oh, he's fast, but he's got a reputation.
He does have a reputation, and that's one thing that just entered my mind right now, because when I watched Michael Werner leave the pits in the 38 car, with all of his experience, he was very, very cautious on that lap out. Now, Kammer may not be as familiar, so 38 has gone by right now as Kammer is leaving the pits. Let's keep an eye on him, because these tires are stone cold, and the more the temperature drops, the longer it takes to get the race tire up to temperature where they have good grip once again. This will be pretty close to treacherous right now. It'll feel like a car almost driving on a snowy condition. The level of grip is so low, it'll be shocking.
Into dusk now, we're going to say it. Gather up here slowly. Not yet ready to pull up the racetrack. This is still the exit road from pit road.
No,
dump him onto the racetrack.
Yeah, I think you'll see the car maybe snake a little bit under acceleration, because it will not put the power down right. It won't turn in well. Kammer has to be very careful. I'm sure that Brad Kettler has rated him and said, take it easy. Be very, very careful. There's no reason to risk it right now.
So the team car, the 38, J.J. Leto, Marco Werner, they're back in the lead. Werner has taken it over. As we are into hour number three, the Mazda Series Sports Car Championships here will go to second. Kaffer heading up the hill toward the corkscrew for the first time on his first stint of the day. James Weaver had gone by, and Rob Dyson's 16 car that low over the AER power plant, the Thetford Norcold machine, and they are now in second spot. Let's get an update from pit road, Calvin Fish.
Well, Johnny Herbert here getting a slug of Red Bull. Johnny, really up against it after the first corner. Do you have any idea what happened to you from behind?
Well, I think it was it was one of the Dysons, I'm not sure. I think it was Chris Dyson who was in the car. And it was silly because he tapped me more than halfway through the corner, and that was enough to spin us round. And then you start at the back, and then you got to pass the cars. And unfortunately, when you get behind Butch, it was very hard to get close enough to be able to pass him. And then latterly, when I got behind the Zytek, the same thing. But we lost so much time at the beginning, and it was just a fight of trying as hard as we could and trying to keep as clean as we could. But it's still a bit of time to go. Hopefully a bit of luck will go away, and you never know.
You never know, as he said, and certainly the two cars seem to be getting slightly better mileage, Rick, than the 38 car right now.
As we watch Kaffer now third overall, James Weaver, Butch Leitzinger, they move to second on the board. That's the car that won Mosport, that Lolo with the AER car plant. Here's Kaffer moving by the 56 with Willman. Let's update John GTS. Ollie Gavin in the number four Corvette is leading the category. Bill, he's fourth overall.
These cars are just so good. They're incredibly strong and beautifully maintained. Ollie is just having a really nice run here, but he really is only about, let's see here, 13 seconds ahead of his own teammates.
Johnny O'Connor, number three car,
is still really within striking distance, and Ollie has to be careful.
Lolo, the 37 in T1, the Intersport car, they are fourth, rather fifth overall, right behind Gavin. There is either James's car, the number 10, the Motorsports machine. They're back on the race track. James Gouet is driving the
plus
track right now, trying to get James
to the three car.
The
plus 14 to the three car.
As we take a look at this beautiful Corvette, let's update you on what 2005 might bring in the GTS category. Two brand new C6s from the CompuWare team.
Yeah, I can't wait to see those. And everything that we have heard, they're very close-lipped about just how good they are. But all of the things are very positive. The Asenco Celine will be back, and this one's really exciting. Pro Drive, the team that we saw run a pair of Ferraris last year that, in fact, dominated this event, will be back with a pair of new 12-cylinder Aston Martins.
and those very Ferraris that I spoke about? How about Bobby Rahal? Would that be something?
Well, he's been over here looking at the American Le Mans series for quite some time. Dick Barber has been very successful, may end up with those cars. And Signor Raffinelli could end up with the Pro Drive Ferraris and run them in GTS. It'll be a great GTS season come 2005. Gavin leads O'Connell, Terry Porcheller, and Tom Whitehart in GTS, and the pressure is on. Sports coverage of the American Le Mans Series of Laguna Seca being brought to you today by Audi. Get exceptional values now on your own Audi at the Race to Audi Days. Hurry, the race is on. Back at Laguna Seca, the Corvette's leading GTS on pit road, Calvin Fish.
The leader, the number four car driven by Oliver Gavin, is in, certainly you can see that. And there's now Olivier Beretta behind the wheel, and right behind him, Johnny O'Connell brought the three car in to turn it over to Ron Fellows. This is the first time that this team has run on Michelin tires here at Laguna Seca, and they're certainly seeing a vast improvement in the handling. Let's look at the team this weekend. He said in terms of spring rate, we've gone from a 900 to a 1450. That's the amount of lateral drift they're able to generate, and that's what spring rate they need to keep the car going. Underway as they finish the service on the three, Rick.
Great battle between these two teammates. And Bill, when you're battling your teammate for victory, what goes through your mind?
You never want to take him out. I mean, that's number one, because you know if you hit that car, take him out, you've just effectively finished your career in the team. But there's a lot of ego. I mean, I mentioned earlier in that piece about the fire extinguishers that race drivers are very afraid of fire. They're also afraid of being the slowest driver on a team.
Sure.
Nobody wants to be the slowest driver. And that boils down into cars. Yeah, number three wants to be number four and vice versa.
A lot of pride at stake on this CompuWare Corvette team. Interesting, 8 races of the season complete coming here. This is the 9th and final. Each of these cars have won 4 times.
Keep going.
And the 4 car with Beretta and Gavin had won the last 3. So and for the 3 team, I talked to Fellows this morning, he said, hey, Johnny and I really want to win this one and end the year on the three.
And one of the critical parts, too, is that Gavin did lead a lot of races early, but because of their style, because Ollie tends to push very hard, he was putting the car in more precarious positions and a couple of times was taken out by incidents. That just let Ron and Johnny come through and take the victory.
Sorry, I lost you there just for a second.
I do like their style.
Go as good as you can. We're in pretty good shape. There's something wrong with the four car. Electronics-wise, they got to shut the engine off and start it back up. They're going to try to do it when they're running.
Don't know if we can go back and look, but when I saw the four come around the exit road from the pits heading toward turn three, it looked as though they had a problem. It looked as though the car was in the gravel there. We can go back and see that. But meantime, the three may be in position to score that season-ending victory.
And again, for viewers wondering why shut the car off, what that would do is to reset the computer. That's why he would do that.
Well, downstairs, let's get an update on the four. Calvin Fish.
Ollie, you just jumped out of the four car in the lead. How's the car performing? Any problems whatsoever?
No, not really. Everything's really running pretty clockwork. The CompuWare Chevrolet Corvette car is fantastic at the moment. And, you know, the Michelin tires have been hanging up really, really well. You know, it's going pretty much the plan. Traffic's always hard around here. It's a tough track, and it's going to get even harder now. It's getting darker. So you've got to really have your wits about you. You know, it's going to be an interesting next couple of hours.
So you hear that Olivier had to reset the electrics, but talk about the fact that you've not been able to win the Drivers' Championship. But in terms of wins, if you win here today, it'll give you the edge in the win column. Is that an added incentive for you boys?
Well, it's always got to be a bit of an added incentive, yeah. So, you know, it's not lost on us. So, yeah, we are looking at that. I just want to thank everybody at GM Racing for the job they've done this year. It's been fantastic. I hope that this is his last race here with the C5. We all go out with a great result and hopefully another one too.
For that perfect season, Rick.
Well, it would be an unprecedented feat, but there's some smoke showing out of the back of the corner. I'd seen that earlier too, Bill.
Boy, and he slid very wide going in the corn through there. He couldn't get that car slowed down nearly enough, so I wonder if they should be leaking something maybe on the front end of the car. Let's watch as he comes into this tight corner next. See if he's able to break their major brake a little earlier. That's under heavy braking right there. Couldn't make out what he said there.
Now, Beretta still got the lead though in GTS, still fifth overall. Johnny Fellows are just 2.5 seconds back.
Plus 2.6 to the three car, plus 2.6.
Okay,
well, at one point, that was a 13-second lead the number four car had.
Racing Radio's team communications, and you saw the gap as they exited turn two. There are the two Corvettes. It's about 15 car lengths, Calvin Fish.
There is a slight problem with the number four car. I just spoke to the crew chief here, and he said, yes, when we refired the car, the ECU went into a default mode. We're trying to discuss with Olivier how we can reset that, actually turn the engine on and back on again, off and back on again, whilst he's running on the racetrack. So hopefully it won't cost him too much time, and he can hold that lead over the sister car.
But Ron Fellows in that three, I know, smells some blood in the water in GTS. Hey, coming up next, NBC brings you final round coverage of the Samsung World Championship. Is the leader by three strokes over Annika Sorenstam and Christy Kara. The Samsung World Championships are up next here on NBC Sports.
You know, again, I saw that burst of smoke, Rick, off the back of the four car breaking up into the corkscrew area.
So the Corvettes dominating GTS, but can Beretta and Gavin close the deal and win their fifth of the season? We'll find out. Back at Laguna Seca on NBC Sports, prototype 2 leader Robin Liddell brings the 30 car to a stop. Going to fuel the car, change driver, John Vegas.
They have been on the radio. They tend to remind drivers to undo the belts, which side of the car you're going to go out. Not that they haven't done it a million times, but there's something about having the reassurance on the radio exactly what steps you're going to go through. Now, Clint Field is going to take over the driving duties, and again, they can only drivers, they can do no work on the car until the fueling is complete. It does appear as though there are no tires set out at the moment, so we will make an assumption that this is going to be a double stint on the Pirelli tires.
That's a good sign.
That smoke that you see just affected the brakes. Yep. So hot.
Exactly. Sometimes little tiny bits of rubber, you can't even see any right there to point out, but they'll occasionally fall onto the hot rotor. That's all you see, just the smoke. There's nothing to worry about.
Less than an hour and 20 to go.
Actually,
now without it,
maybe right, just back down there.
Without a tire change, Bill, can they go to the end on the set turns? They'll double stint?
Possibly. I mean, as the temperatures fall, the tire wear is going to get better and better. And one of the problems that the Pirelli tires have always had is overheating when you wear out quickly.
Hey, clear to go, clear to go. Watch your pit speed, watch your pit speed. Remember, we want to stay in fuel best we can. Forget about it. An hour and 20 minutes remaining. We want to save fuel best.
Good communication there by the team, just making sure that Clint understands exactly what's taking place. Also, watch the pit speed. Again, for new viewers, most of these race cars have pit speed limiters installed on. Just a button on the steering wheel. The car will not exceed the speed limit that it's supposed to do it on the pit lane. So that, too, helps the drivers.
Oakland Field takes the car over, seventh overall, with a solid lead in P2 down to Jan Bikas.
With Robin Liddell, we tried to talk to you in the car. We'll do it in pit road instead. How was the car? What were the track conditions for you?
The car was very good. And in fact, the car got better as the session went on because obviously the track temperature's dropping, so I was just finding I was going quicker and quicker. There was a bit of a fright at the end, though, because obviously the other car, the P1 car, blew up, so there was smoke all the way around the circuit, and it was just like a big smoke screen. Everybody was braking because they couldn't see where they were going. But the track conditions are very good. The car's very good, and we're fortunate now to be back in the lead, so hopefully Clint can stay there and we'll get, I think it's our seventh win in the season.
Is that why you made the decision to double stint, because the car got better as it got colder?
Well, Rick did a shortened stint in the middle, so it kind of, we thought we could do it on four stints completely, but obviously we had to change again, so Clint's now hopefully going to do a full stint till the end, but we didn't want to take too much of a risk with the fuel there. If we need to splash and dash, it's probably safer to do that. We had some fuel surge at Road Atlanta, and obviously the tank's not picking up the last couple of liters.
Thank you, Robert.
Thank you.
Calvin?
Well, the GT leader is in, and as Jörg Bergmeister jumping out, going to turn it over to Timo Bernard, and hopefully Timo can take this car to at least a finish here tonight, and hopefully the victory and clinch that driver's championship. And just as we thought that Alex Job were vulnerable this year, they've come back with five straight victories between the two cars, and tonight would be six. Certainly been a flawless weekend for Timo Bernard and his driver. They've been fastest in every single session. They lead the race right now. They're waiting for the last gas of fuel to go in. It'll be one final set of Michelin tires, and hopefully Timo can take the driver's championship tonight, Rick.
Radio check, Timo. Radio check.
Copy, you're loud and clear.
Reset fuel.
And the service continuing for the Alex Jobe team. Tires going on. Bernhard back in the saddle. He's in line to become the American Le Mans Series Drivers Champion in GT. He needs six or better in GT, but they are the race leaders as he heads out on the racetrack. Now, earlier, while we were away, a couple of things have happened, and problems for the Intersport team in a couple of areas. This is their prototype one Lola, Bill. John Field had that engine just let go on.
He sure did. That's the end of a very expensive race engine, just belching smoke out the back as that dies on the track. And the best thing about this, the only good thing you can say about an engine blowing up, is it's not laying down any oil on the track. It is only smoke getting rid of the California mosquitoes.
So John Field retiring the 37 car, short of the finish here tonight. They were up in the top five earlier. Could be the end of the line for Intersport Racing and that race car. Talked to John earlier this weekend. That tub, the carbon fiber chassis of that car has cracked and been fixed so many times. He said it's got too much flex in it. We can't really run it anymore. Meantime, their P2 car that's leading the race, they're going to have to serve a penalty. Their driver support person in that last pit stop, not properly attired, no goggles, so a penalty upcoming on the 30. Now, American Le Mans Series and Pirelli Tire joined up earlier this summer to sponsor an internet contest. The contest winner, Cassandra Williams, being hosted here this weekend by Pirelli.
I'm going to give you this certificate, which you can take to your Pirelli tire dealer, and that will get you the tires. Thanks very much, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your weekend.
Thank you. I had a great time, and I'm loving it here. It is really, really nice.
Cassandra and her sister Katrina from Detroit, Michigan, enjoying the ambiance and the excitement of an American Le Mans Series weekend here at Laguna Seca Raceway in Monterey, California. As we watch Clint Field in car number 30 leading the prototype two standings, he has to serve a penalty upcoming after his last pit stop. Day in tonight, final hour upcoming here on NBC Sports. Your leader, Marco Werner. Welcome back to Laguna Seca in Monterey, California on NBC Sports. Final round of the American Le Mans Series for 2004, the Sports Car Championship at Laguna Seca. I'm Rick Benjamin. Bill Adam is alongside Calvin Fish and Jan Bikas on pit road as we take a look at our race leader from our Porsche mail-to-web aerial platform. Rain has been falling here as we get to the last 17, 18 minutes of racing. The lead car continues to be the ADT champion Audi of Marco Werner, car number 38. They've got a 10-second lead over their team car, the Audi number 2 of Pierre Capel. The rain had started earlier. We had a full course caution briefly. Now rain has returned. The caution was not caused by the rain. It was for a car that was off course. Okay. Let's take you back through some highlights of the last many moments here. In GTS, the Asemco Saline on pit road for a long period of time. They had concerns that water was leaking out of that race car. They sprayed the radiators down and so forth. Let's hear more about that.
Coming straight out the back, guys. Water's just running right out the back.
Now what this is an overflow system on the car. They tried to purge the system using a pressurized water tank to put new, cooler water to the system. That just blows the old hot stuff out the back.
Roger, it's a full course.
Team manager Jim Bell talking to his driver. Now the Corvettes stopped together, Jan Bikas, and there was a lead change on pit road.
Yes, there was. Watch the car in the front, the 4 car. It actually came on the pit road first, but there was a problem. Look, the jubilation from the crew behind, the stopping of the feet from the crew in front. It all came down to one lug nut. There was a problem on the 4 car on the right rear, and that position change happened quickly.
So Johnny O'Connell leads GTS. Calvin.
Well, problems continue for the number 10 Miracle Motorsports. Ian James survived a scare earlier in this race when the rod end broke on the front suspension. His teammate James Huey now behind the wheel reports that there's some kind of steering issue. Once again, the car is weaving around on the straightaways and the team are trying to identify what the problem is. So this is scary moments for this team. They're within a whisker of capturing the Drivers' Championship for young Ian James.
So they worked on the car extensively on pit road, got it ready to return. JJ Leto smiling on pit road with the rain back falling, and we have a full course caution being thrown by IMSA officials and one of the ADT champion Audis on pit road. Race leader Marco Werner down there, Calvin Fish.
Yes, this rain is coming down pretty heavily right now, and Marco Werner and the champion team are taking no risk whatsoever. They're switching to the Michelin wet weather tire. They're going to try and get him back out. The question will be is whether the two car tries to gamble and keep Pierre Kappa out on slick tires. We don't believe the rain will last long, so it's a question of whether these drivers can hang on under these very slippery conditions.
Just more than 16 minutes remaining in competition here. Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca, but you can see the rain falling now in our camera look down on pit road. It is a full course yellow for the second time in the last hour. This one is because of the rain. Earlier, one of the Porsches in GT, the PK Racing 60 car with Pierce Maserati, had stopped on course. They got him off the racetrack. We restarted, but now the rain has returned. Audi continues to lead here at the final race in 2004 for the American Le Mans Series. Now, since 2000, the Audi R8s have dominated in American Le Mans Series action. They've won four straight championships, first with the Yost team, this year with champion Audi. The success of the R8, 39 series wins, five straight wins at Le Mans, can be traced to a philosophy of how these cars were designed from conception.
I think that we've been approaching the sports car maybe a little bit different than others. For sure, we wanted to create a racing machine that is optimized to weight, power, and a minimum of drag with a maximum of downforce. But beside that, we tried to add some values to the car, like serviceability, like the chance to change, for example, the rear end very quickly. And we, at the end, created a car. It was easy to handle for the mechanics. It was a car that was easy to learn on. And I think that it is a part of the success.
But it's all about Audi once again. The clock has struck four local time, and Sagiara wins. But more importantly, Tom Christensen is a six-time winner at Le Mans.
Dr. Ulrich is quick to point out that while the car's success may be based largely on great design, the fate of the beautiful R8s is ultimately in the hands of the teams and the drivers that campaign the cars.
There is a car, but there is a big team around it. And especially in sports car and endurance, it's a team effort. And our people in Audi Sport, they have proved to be a big family working for one target. And we managed to get good teams working with us, like Yost, that brought a lot of input into that system. And we just put it all together in a big pot. And I think it was an excellent meal at the end.
Heavy rain now falling, at least on the front straightaway here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. 13 and a half minutes of action remaining here, but the question is, what will happen with these teams as they bring just about everyone onto the pit road now to change to rain tires? Bill, there's enough rain falling that you really can't run on slicks anymore. Well, we will continue more coverage from Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, the season finale of the American Le Mans Series. Here are your category leaders. We'll be back. Let's take a look back at some highlights from the season finale for the American Le Mans Series. In broad daylight, the green flag, Nicholas Minashian took the early lead. The two car, one of the ADT champion Audis, Johnny Herbert spun in turn two, got clipped by Chris Dyson. Great Dyson for the lead during the first hour. Minashian out in front. JJ Leto got by him coming off the final corner. But now Minashian would return the favor going down into turn two on the same lap. Leto fought back. A couple of laps later, again in turn 11, Leto to the inside with the help of a slower car, retook the lead. The ADT champion 38 car has dominated much of the Audi Sports Car Championships here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Now the battle for the title in Prototype 2 was a keen one. Ian James trying to lock up the championship in the Miracle Motorsports 10 car, the Garage. They've had mechanical troubles a couple of times today, but they only needed to finish 70% of the race laps, and they have done so. The pole sitter's car, Minashian, behind the wall. They had throttle problems. The throttle stuck on the car a couple of times. In GTS, a battle between the two factory Corvettes, the CompuWare cars. The four car of Olivier Bretta and Ali Gavin led much of the day, but on a late pit stop, that changed. One of the prototype contenders, John Field in the 37 car, the Intersport Lola, had a motor blow at about halfway. He was done for the day. We've had a late restart under pouring rain conditions. And it's been great drama here in the last few minutes. Just a couple of moments to go. And the ADT champion Audi number two with Pierre Coffer is your race leader by a lap. I'll show you why he took the lead when his teammate, Marco Werner in the 38. Take a look at the top of your screen here. Now remember, this is as cars were stopping on pit road to get rain tires under caution. Take a look here. We'll see the Audi loop it off the final corner. They elected to stay out and Werner spun. We have an onboard view for you. Werner came to a stop here. Let's take a look. Hard to see in the dark conditions here, but Werner came off the final corner, did not go to pit road, and had the car go around on him. By the time he got restarted, pointed in the right direction, his teammate Coffer had pitted for Reigns, and he was out in front. Now, we showed you the Miracle Motorsports team and their drama tonight. Ian James, James Gouet, and John Macaluso. Well, they've completed enough laps to give James the driver's championship in P2, but during the rain, they spun. The car went off course and stopped on the beach.
Oh, they have just about done everything possible to try and give away this championship, but they keep soldiering on. And it seems almost remarkable. This was just a couple of moments. There they are, stopped up against the wall. It looks like they will not actually take the checkered flag, but as you point out, they will win the championship.
With 2 minutes of racing to go, it appears that in Prototype 2, Clint Field will win the race. The championship will go to Ian James and the Miracle Motorsports team. Now, while all this was unfolding, Calvin Fish had a chance to talk to James about the title.
Well, the Miracle Motorsports team have recovered. They've got past the 70% mark. They're classified tonight, and Ian James, that gives you the championship. But what a roller coaster of emotion for you.
Oh, can I tell you? I mean, first couple of hours, we were three laps in the lead. Everything was great. Huge moment when we had a component failure, got it back together. James is in the car now, doing a great job. I mean, this year has been such a roller coaster, but, you know, happy to win the championship and look forward to the future.
Congratulations, mate. Awesome job.
Thanks, Calvin.
All right, the thoughts of Ian James earlier. Now, there is some controversy at the front of the field. It's, again, an inter-squad rivalry, Calvin Fish. They'll feel getting the white flag this time by, but the Audi team in a bit of a dispute here.
Right now, the 38 team are claiming that they didn't get credited with their in-lap when they switched to the wet weather tires. So right now, they're trying to work with the officials here to try to see if there is a scoring error. Either way, it'll be a champion driver winning here tonight. But whether it's the 2 or the 38, we'll try and figure it out, Rick.
Right now, it's Pierre Coffer in the number 2 ADT champion Audi. That's the second car that they just added at Petit Le Mans about a month ago with the lead. The white flag in the air this time with 45 seconds of racing to go. There's the white flag at the Laguna Seca Bridge heading into turn 2.
You know, JJ Leto right now just must be feeling deja vu, because a few years back at Petit Le Mans, a 10-hour race with a couple of minutes to go, his co-driver spun and lost the race for him. Here they've had this simply brilliant day where they've led almost the entire race. Now his co-driver spins. Is it happening again?
Marco Werner in second spot as things are shown right now. Third to Butch Leitzinger in Prototype 1 and overall in Rob Dyson's Lola AER car. Final lap as we take a look at the race leader from our Porsche mail-to-web aerial camera tonight here at Laguna Seca. The American Le Mans Series wrapping up its sixth season, another stunning year of great competition in all four categories. We at NBC Sports have been proud to be a part of this series since its inception. Enjoy bringing these American Le Mans Series telecasts over the last many years. Race leader head up the hill toward the corkscrew, final time. We have had hard rain. It seems to have eased a bit. Fortunately, everybody in the field has been to pit road for rain tires, so there shouldn't be any issue getting the two car home here tonight to the checkered flag.
No, I think, you know, a lot of credit goes to Brad Kettler and the whole champion crew here, because this was a team that back in 1993, they started. The first time I ever met Dave Mirage was at Sebring under one of these spindly little aluminum tents that you hardly can cover a picnic table with. And now he has built up a team that, in the words of the top people in Audi, is better than Yost. I mean, the ultimate compliment. These guys have just done such a great job.
For those of us who were around during the Yost years, that is a heavy compliment.
Tremendous.
Indeed. Here comes Coffer in car number 2. He and Johnny Herbert will score the season-ending victory at the Audi Sports Car Championships at Laguna Seca Raceway.
Good job, boys. Good job. Thanks for everything. Edge, the car was perfect. Perfect.
When you win, the car is always perfect.
Coffer on the radio, talking to his team, congratulating them on a great effort tonight here at Laguna Seca Raceway. So Coffer and Johnny Herbert, you saw Herbert there on pit road, being lifted in celebration of their first victory of the American Le Mans Series season. As we take a timeout, let's show you the other category winners here in Laguna Seca. We'll be back. Today's NBC Sports coverage of the American Le Mans Series at Laguna Seca has been brought to you by the new Chevrolets. 10 new cars and trucks in 20 months, an American revolution. And by Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. Back at Laguna Seca, final checkered flag of 2004 in the American Le Mans Series. Pierre Kaffer wins Prototype 1, Clint Field in Prototype 2. Johnny O'Connell wins GTS, Mark Lieb in GT. Let's talk to our overall winner.
Well, in very tricky conditions, it's Johnny Herbert and Pierre Kaffer who come through for the victory tonight. And Pierre, talk about the conditions there in the final hour.
Yeah, there was unbelievable, this condition. I never had this before in my life. It was just unbelievable. And I nearly crashed the car. It was so slippery outside. I never had this before. Thanks at the team. They give me in the right moment the wet tires. So I think we could go to the lead, but I tell you, it was really, really slippery outside.
Superb job.
Thanks.
Now Prototype 2, the race victory to the Intersport team. Clint Field, Robin Liddell, Rick Sutherland. Third spot to the Intersport team. Ian James, he wins the season championship along with James Gouet. Let's take a look at our GT class results. Mark Lieb, Romain Dumas for the Alex Jobe team. And the season champion, Timo Bernhard with Jörg Bergmeister. Let's hear now from the 2004 champion.
Well, he didn't capture the victory here today, but he got the victory in the championship. Timo Bernhard second tonight, but the driver's championship has to be sweet for you.
Yeah, that was a big goal this year, and we achieved it. Thank you to Alex Jobe and to Porsche. It was perfect year, and I'm very happy to win this championship. I'm a little disappointed that we didn't win because we were leading every session. We were leading the whole race until the rain came. But I made an early pit stop, and that screwed us up. Normally, we would have won, but it was raining so hard that I thought I have to come in to get some rain tires, to get on the safe side. I wanted to be on the safe side. The championship was the main goal.
Well, the big picture was certainly completed here tonight, Rick.
And in GTS, Ron Fellows and Johnny O'Connell win their fifth of the season. They are the GTS season champions. A late race pit stop gave them the victory in GTS tonight. Well, coming up next, it's final round coverage of the Samsung World Championship. I'm Rick Benjamin. For my colleagues Bill Adam, Jan Bikas, and Calvin Fish, it has been a joy to be with you on NBC Sports. We say so long from Monterey, California, the American Le Mans Series at Laguna Seca. Your winners, Pierre Kaffer and Johnny Herbert. This is the American Le Mans Series on NBC.
Stop us.